Hello friends, my name is Utkarsh Upadhyay and this is the second lecture of EDC. Hopefully you must have gone through the lecture 1. So you must go through this lecture only after reading whatever I taught in the lecture 1. So let's start with this lecture.
Okay.
So in this case we are going to discuss mobility of charge carriers. Mobility of charge carriers. Just change the color. So basically, mobility is defined as drift velocity upon field intensity. Drift velocity is the velocity of the charge carriers in the presence of the electric field intensity. That is what meant by drifting of the charge carriers. Drifting only takes place in the presence of electric field intensity. I must write it here. Drifting takes place only in the presence of field. So unit for mobility is centimeter square per volt second, or it could be meter square per volt second. So we define the mobility as mu, we denote the mobility as mu, and drift velocity is Vd upon electric field intensity. This is how the mobility of the charge carriers is defined. Mobility denotes how fast is the charge carrier is moving from one place to another. So basically, mobility denotes how fast our charge carriers is moving from one place to another. So let us classify the values of mobility of the charge carriers, that is electron and hole, in germanium and silicon. So electron mobility, and this is hole mobility. Let's draw the table. Electron mobility and hole mobility, this is for germanium and this is for silicon. So electron mobility in germanium is 3800 centimeter square per volt second, and for silicon it is 1300 centimeter square per volt second, and hole mobility is 1800 centimeter square per volt second and 500 centimeter square per volt second. These are the approximate values. Actual value, it may these values may differ from the actual values, but they are all approximately the same. So as you can see, the mobility of the charge carriers in germanium is greater than that in silicon. So it is important to note down that the mobility of charge carriers in germanium is greater than mobility of charge carriers in silicon. Okay, so this is the point which is worth noting. I advise you to keep these values in your mind. Whenever you encounter the question which incorporates usage of the mobility charge mobility values, it must be given in the question. If it is not given, then you have to use your brain. So I advise you to remember these values. It's not that important, but it's worth remembering them. So from here we also notice that the mobility of the electrons in both silicon and germanium is greater than that of holes. So since electron mobility is greater than hole mobility, the electrons move faster than holes and also contribute more current when compared to hole. So this is also important. Since mobility of the electrons is greater than mobility of holes, the electrons move faster than holes and also contribute more current when compared to hole. Okay, so if we just see, germanium has large conductivity, they have large conductivity and they are relatively more suitable for high frequency applications. Germanium is basically used for high frequency application, and this is because due to large gain bandwidth product, wherein for silicon, if we consider silicon, has relatively small conductivity, because conductivity depends upon mobility. I will discuss about conductivity in the later section of the lecture. Also, these are suitable for power amplifiers. These are also suitable for power amplifiers. Silicon can handle more power when compared to germanium and also gallium arsenide. So basically, since it is used in power amplifiers, it is worth noting that silicon can handle more power when compared to germanium and gallium arsenide. Gallium arsenide is basically a compound type semiconductor. Germanium is element type semiconductor. I will discuss about this in the later section. Mobility of charge carriers. Now it is worth noting. Now let's have a look at the variation in mobility with the temperature. If we change the temperature, what is the effect on mobility? So mobility versus temperature. Mobility versus temperature. So mobility of charge carriers decreases with temperature. Now mobility of charge carriers decreases with temperature. That is mu directly proportional to T to the power minus N, provided it only is applicable for valid for 100 Kelvin less than T 400 Kelvin. Temperature is between these two. If these two conditions are satisfied, then mobility of charge carrier decreases with temperature. Right, for 400 Kelvin and greater than 100 Kelvin, and without considering scattering effect. This is important to note down. So Let's note down the values of n. So if we m is basically a constant, if n is equal to 1.66 for electron and is equal to 2.33 for holes, this is for germanium, and n is equal to 2.5 for electrons and 2.7 for holes. They are the experimental values. It's not important to remember these values, and I would not advise you to cram these values because it's not that required. Okay. So, considering the scattering effects in semiconductor, the mobility of the charge carriers first increases with temperature and then decreases with temperature. Now, let's have very deep understanding of what's the understanding of the variation of mobility of the charge carriers with the temperature. So, I'm drawing the variation plot. This is the mobility of the charge carriers. This is for electron and hole. This is the temperature axis. Okay, so we now the variation, the plot looks something like this. It's more seamless and it's more smooth. So this is the variation of the mobility of the charge carriers with the temperature. The relation between these two is mu directly proportional to t to the power 3 by 2. Here it is mu directly proportional to t to the power minus 3 by 2. This portion, this is due to the mobility charge case increases with temperature if we consider impurity scattering and this is due to lattice scattering. These are two important phenomena, and this plot is important. You have to remember this plot. The variation of the mobility of the charge carriers with the temperature, and this plot will be used in solving multiple questions and answering the theoretical questions as well. So mobility charge carriers decreases with the doping. Now let's move on to the next topic of discussion. Now let's see the variation of mobility with doping. Doping is nothing but the addition of the pentavalent or trivalent impurities in the semiconductor in order to improve its conductivity. That's what the doping is. I will explain it later section. Just to remember this thing, the doping is meant by addition or incorporation of the pentavalent and the trivalent impurities in the semiconductor in order to improve its conductivity. That's what is meant by doping. Okay. So I'm writing a point here that mobility of the charge carriers decreases with doping concentration. Mobility of the charge carriers decreases with doping concentration. As temperature is kept constant, and by increasing the doping concentration into the semiconductor, the atom concentration in the semiconductor increases, and this will reduce the mobility of charge carriers, and hence mobility decreases. So this is the plot This is the mobility of the charge carrier axis, and this is doping concentration. Change the color. So this is the variation. This is the mobility of the electron variation and mobility of P. Keeping in mind mobility of the electrons is greater than mobility of holes. So this is the variation of mobility of the charge carriers with doping concentration, and that's applicable for electrons and holes as well, for both. Okay, now if we consider different type of effects that are taking place inside the semiconductor, like impurity scattering, lattice scattering, surface scattering, this will basically result into a very small a smaller value of the mobility of the charge carriers. So I must write this point here. It is worth noting that in a semiconductor there will be different types of scattering mechanisms. Like impurity scattering, lattice scattering, surface scattering, and due to this resulting mobility of charge carriers reduces, and hence net mobility is given by 1 by mu net is equal to 1 by mu 1 plus 1 by mu 2 plus 1 by mu 3 plus and so on and so forth. This is the thing. So net mobility of the charge carriers will be less than each of the mobilities, individual mobilities, mu 1, mu 2, mu 3 and so forth. So mu 1, mu 2, mu 3 are the mobilities due to each type of the scattering mechanisms taking place, and mu net is the net mobility of the charge carriers. So the net mobility mu net is even less than the least of the individual ones. Okay, so far so good. Now we have seen the variation in the mobility of the charge carriers with temperature as well as doping concentration. We have seen what is the effect on the mobility of the charge carriers because of doping and some of the scattering phenomena taking place. Now let's have a keen look at the variation in the mobility with electric field intensity. This is important. This portion is important. Variation in the mobility of the charge carriers with electric field intensity. So let me first draw the plot that would represent the same. This is the mobility plot and this is for electric field intensity. This I am taking this in volts per centimeter. This is in volts per centimeter. Let me just change the color so that it makes it more legible and more credible to you to understand. So let me just take the blue color. Now this is applicable for electrons and holes. This is constant for certain value of the electric field intensity. This is 10 to the power 10 to the power 3 volts per centimeter. This is constant, it does not vary with electric field intensity. Then there is a hyperbolic decrease, you can see mobility of the charge carriers up to 10 to the power 4 volts per centimeter, and then it decreases like this. It is at 10 to the power 7 volts per centimeter. This variation relation is written by mu is inversely proportional to square root of electric field intensity. This is equal to mobility proportional to 1 by E. Okay. So after this, this plot repeats itself. From here, repeats itself. Okay. So smaller electric field intensity, this is very large electric field intensity. Okay. Let us write some points from here. Now let's try to understand what is the effect of this sort of relationship on the drift velocity of the charge carriers. Let's have a look at that. So if we consider first portion, let's say this is, let's mark it as A, this is B and this is C. In A, if we consider A portion, so electric field is small and the mobility remains constant. Mu is constant and electric field is increasing. We are going from left to right. So Vd is basically equal to mu into E. Since mu is constant, E is increasing, so Vd also increases. So drift velocity increases. Vd increases. B, let's move on to B. Electric fields are larger. So here you can see electric field are larger for 10 to the power 4 volts per centimeter. Mobility decreases. Mu decreases. Okay. Drift velocity enters into a saturation. So it's basically a sublinear region. It's basically represents a sublinear region. The portion B represents the sublinear region. Sublinear region. Your Vd is equal to mu into E. So there is some sort of ambiguous relationship which you can see is inversely proportional to square root of E. Vd increases. Vd definitely increases. Your mobility decreases. E increases. So it is basically sublinear region. This is a linear region. And if we just see, when electric fields are very, very high, mobility, since Vd, mu decreases with increase in electric field intensity. So mu is equal to, Vd is equal to mu into E. Electric field increases, mu decreases with the same rate. So Vd remains constant. This is a saturation region. This is saturation. So portion A represents linear region, portion B represents sublinear region, portion C represents a saturation region. Let me draw the plot that would represent the same actions taking place. So here if you just see variation of drift velocity with the electric field intensity. So this portion, this is represents portion A, this represents portion B, this represents portion C. This is linear, this is sublinear, this is saturation, no variation. And this is again 10 to the power 3, 10 to the power 4. After that it will basically remains constant. This is again in volts per centimeter. So let me summarize this thing. So in a semiconductor, as field intensity increases gradually, drift velocity first increases linearly, then increases sublinearly, and at very high E, VD becomes constant. It is important to note that this plot is applicable to only indirect band gap semiconductors. Indirect band gap semiconductors. For example, germanium and silicon. This is not the plot of gallium arsenide, which is basically a direct band gap semiconductor. I will explain the difference between indirect band gap semiconductor and direct band gap semiconductor in the later lecture course. Till now, you must note that germanium and silicon are the examples of indirect band gap semiconductor. Both are indirect band gap semiconductor. Gallium arsenide is direct band gap semiconductor. Okay. So let's move to the next topic of discussion, the Einstein equation. This is important. Einstein equation. So for any semiconductor, in a semiconductor, dn by mu n is dp by mu p is vt. Dn and dp individually represent the diffusion constants of electron and hole respectively. Dn is diffusion constant of electron, dp is diffusion constant of holes. Vt is thermal voltage. Vt is thermal voltage. So this sort of Einstein equation, this Einstein equation represents the relationship between diffusion constant, mobility and thermal voltage. Okay, or you can also write mu n by dn is mu p by dp is 1 by vt. So d by mu is proportional to temperature and vice versa. So from here, by comparing the dimension of d and or dp is centimeter square per second. It's important. Centimeter square per second. So this represents the Einstein equation. This is basically an Einstein equation which gives the relationship between the diffusion constant, mobility of the charge carriers and the thermal voltage. Okay. So let's move on to the next discussion. So diffusion constant of charge carriers decreases with temperature. Decreases with temperature as nonlinear variation. So I am considering here the lattice scattering effect. So we know this thing that D is equals to mu Vt. So this Vt increases with temperature, mobility of the charge carrier decreases, D also decreases. So you have the effect of mobility, the effect of change in the mobility is greater on the variation in the diffusion constant. Okay. So for germs, let's basically classify the values of mobility of the charge carriers for germanium and silicon at 300 Kelvin. So I'm writing for germanium at 300 Kelvin. So I'm writing it for 300 Kelvin. Your dN is 99 centimeters square per second. Your dP is 47 centimeters square per second. So dN by mu n, dP by mu p is 2.1. is for silicon at 300 Kelvin, it is dN 34 centimeter square per second. Your dP is 13 centimeter square per second, and dN by mu n, dP by mu p is equal to 2.6. So diffusion constant, you might encounter somewhere in the question as diffusion coefficient. So diffusion constant is also known as diffusion coefficient, also called as diffusion coefficient. Okay, you don't have to remember these values. I'm just written here to establish the dichotomy between the diffusion constant of electrons and holes in each of silicon and germanium. So of course you can see that diffusion constant of electron is greater than diffusion constant of holes, and also obviously diffusion constant of germanium is greater than that of silicon. Diffusion constant is related to the term diffusion. So diffusion is basically the movement of the charge carriers from the higher concentration to the lower concentration. I will explain it later. So till now it is very much important to note these things down. Okay, now let's move to the next topic of discussion, which is the mass action law. This is important, and you must have come across this relationship. So what is the mass action law? Mass action law simply is given by ni square p into n. Ni square, where ni is the intrinsic concentration, p is whole concentration, and n is basically electron concentration. Okay? So n is the concentration of electron, and this is per centimeter cube. This is, the units will be in per centimeter cube. So in extrinsic semiconductor, under thermal equilibrium, the product of electrons and holes concentration is a constant and is equal to ni square. Thermal equilibrium means at a constant temperature, or at a given temperature, or temperature if maintained constant. So thermal equilibrium is, it is what meant by. So thermal equilibrium, let me write this thing. Thermal equilibrium is a constant temperature, or at a given temperature, or temperature is maintained constant. Okay, so this law is generally used for calculating the minority charge carrier concentration in the semiconductor. So for an n-type semiconductor, we just see the, for the n-type semiconductor, we can find out the hole concentration, which is the minority carriers, ni square upon nn. I will also distinguish I will also establish the difference between the n-type and p-type semiconductors in the next lecture. This is for p-type, so we can find out np ni square upon pp. This is how it goes. It is important to note down that this relation does not have any effect if we basically incorporate doping as well. So changing the concentration of electrons and holes in the semiconductor does not have any effect on this relationship. This will remain constant. Let's say N1 P1 is equal to N2 P2 will be equal to Ni square. So N2 and P2 are concentrations after adding the impurity. This will remain constant. This relationship will remain constant all the time. So in semiconductor, before and after adding the atoms or doping, the product NP remains constant. So before and after addition of impurities or doping, NP product remains constant. Okay, and this is important to note down that this relationship is not applicable to degenerate semiconductor. Degenerate semiconductors, which means heavily doped. Heavily doped semiconductor, because in heavily doped semiconductor, the concentration of the minority charge carriers will be nearly negligible. You cannot compare the charge carrier concentration of the minorities with that of the majorities. So mass action law is not applicable for the degenerate semiconductors. Now let's dive deep into the theory behind the intrinsic carrier concentration. So let's just separately discuss intrinsic concentration, which is Ni. Okay, so intrinsic, which means intrinsic, which is meant by pure semiconductor. A pure semiconductor is known as intrinsic semiconductor, and for an intrinsic semiconductor, N is equal to P is equal to Ni. This is for intrinsic semiconductor. For intrinsic semiconductor, concentration of electrons is equal to concentration of holes is equal to Ni, intrinsic carrier concentration. Okay? So Ni denotes the concentration of electron per unit volume or concentration of holes per unit volume. So basically Ni denotes concentration of electrons per unit volume or concentration of holes per unit volume. Okay. So unit for Ni is also per centimeter cube or per meter cube. It's important to note down this thing. Basically, now let's see the variation of Ni with the temperature. Ni is equal to Ni square is equal to A naught T cube e to the power minus Eg naught upon KT. I will derive this expression later onwards. Till now, as of now, just keep this relationship in your mind. So Ni, or you can write Ni is equal to square root of A naught T to the power 3 by 2 e to the power minus Eg naught upon 2 KT. This relationship is important for solving many theoretical questions that you will encounter in the examination. So from here we can infer that Ni square is proportional to T cube, or Ni is proportional to T to the power 3 by 2. So this is the relationship between the temperature and Ni. This is important. This relationship is very important. You should keep this thing in your mind. Ni increases with increase in temperature. And this is a non-linear variation. And this is a non-linear variation. So from here we can infer that Ni is a function of temperature and Eg naught. Energy is basically the energy band gap at 0 Kelvin. Eg naught is the energy band gap at 0 Kelvin. So when compared to silicon germanium, germanium has large value of Ni, and this is due to smaller value of Eg naught. So for since germanium has a smaller value of Eg naught, your Ni in case of germanium is greater than that of silicon, since Eg naught for germanium is less than Eg naught for silicon. Hence Ni in case of germanium is greater than Ni in case of silicon. This is the main reason behind the difference in the values which I showed a couple of minutes ago. So for germanium at 300 Kelvin, the value of Ni is 2.5 into 10 to the power 13 per centimeter cube. And for silicon at 300 Kelvin, Ni value is 1.5 into 10 to the power 10 per centimeter cube. It's not that compulsory to remember this value, but I would suggest you to remember these values, because it might happen you might not get these values in the questions if asked in the examination. So it's better to remember these values. So you can see that Ni for germanium is greater than that of silicon. Okay. That's all, folks. I am ending this lecture here, and hopefully you must have understood the theory well which I taught you in this lecture. It's important to remember the points which I marked separately as important, because these you might encounter the questions in the examination that could possibly require the usage of